Good morning. Welcome to Cornerstone Baptist. We're glad you're here. We may even have to kick the AC on by the time we're done. It's nice to have that. What a beautiful day yesterday for a wedding, and a beautiful day today to be together as the Lord's people, the Lord's church in North Jay. Question. Don't know what terminology to use, but would Jesus throw you under the bus for asking a question? Maybe that would be the way to put it. So things like you're reading the Bible and you get to one passage and you say, well, wait a minute here, that doesn't seem to match what's over in this passage. And if you ask a question, are you in trouble for that? Or maybe things are going on in your life and maybe your children didn't turn out the way you were asking the Lord to help your children to turn out, or any number of other things. You made a decision and you truly thought it was the decision the Lord wanted you to make, and then it didn't turn out well. Is it wrong to ask the Lord a question about that? I've known pastors and churches where you couldn't ask questions, where if you asked a Sunday school teacher a question, you'd be condemned for it. You may lose your teaching position if you actually ask a question. Does God get upset if you have doubts? This morning, what we're looking at is John the Baptist. He had introduced Jesus as the Messiah. There's the guy. The terminology used, his fan is in his hand. He's just cleaning house. Today we might say the leaf blower. You know, we're just cleaning everything out. And that's what Messiah is going to do. And John introduces him as that. And then the next thing John knows, he's in prison. And he says, man, if this is the Messiah, he's supposed to be overthrowing Rome. He's supposed to take care of all this stuff. And here I am in prison. So he asks the question, are you the Messiah? Are you the one that we're looking for? Or should we expect somebody else? Now, I don't think John was necessarily asking, look, if you're not going to do your job, we can find somebody to replace you. I don't think that's what John was saying, but I think he had honest doubts. Man, I trusted Jesus. But now I'm not quite sure. Some of you this morning might be like that. You may be having questions about the Lord Jesus. He invites you to come to him with those questions, and that's what we'll be encouraged by this morning in the Gospel of Luke. Let's take our hymnals, hymn number 32, as we begin. Hymn number 32, crown him with many crowns. Let's stand as we sing this.
Of him who died for thee.
we'll be using at this time. I think it's the top one, the hymn on it, "The Lord is Sovereign Over All." The Lord is Sovereign. You'll know the tune when Kristen starts playing it. Person here, that we would be able to focus our eyes and our lives toward a sovereign God who loves us, cares for us, and is in control of this world. Help us as we look around us not to be discouraged, but also help us not to lose faith. Help us not to sink. Help us to trust you with our lives. Even as this morning Jeff has gone to the hospital, I pray that you would comfort him and help the doctors to figure out what's going on in his body. Pray for others that are grieving. Pray for others who are struggling with other areas in their lives. I pray that you would comfort them this morning and help them to come to you with their doubts and then to trust you fully because of your compassion and your care and your control. Encourage us, help us to worship you today, and help that worship to be acceptable in your sight. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. So there's a flyer in the back, if you don't have one with you, about our Singspiration on Friday evening at the Hilton's house. There's instructions there for you on Moose Hill Road and how to get there. It's 6 to 8 Friday evening. If it rains, we'll have it on Saturday instead. So bring your chair and a snack to share. Vacation Bible School is coming up probably more quickly than we imagine. There are still some preparations to be made. There is a sheet in the back on the bulletin board, and I know there's a lot of paper back there. How you tell is it's the one with the tear-offs on it, and it's materials that we need for crafts. And there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, maybe 6 more items to be, 5 more items to be signed up for. So just take a tear-off, and then if you could have it here by next week so that we can understand what we have to purchase, if we have to purchase something or not. Be praying be praying for the preparations being made for VBS, as well as who to invite, for God to prepare their hearts. Understand it's for 2 years old up through sixth grade. We get above that, and it really isn't designed for ages older than that. One of these years, maybe next year again, we'll go back to a teen class and an adult class. I'd love to be able to do that in the future. But this year, it's up through sixth grade. There's a sign up. We had to go and spend a couple cents and print a whole new mowing list, you know, because it was stolen. That's a kind of a running joke here, but there is a mowing list in the back for you to sign up for, as it's that time of year again. Leaders meeting Tuesday, if that's at all possible for you men. Also this week, I want to give you opportunities to do other things and be involved in other churches' lives. Augusta Baptist Church is having evangelist Barry Webb there all week this week. Tomorrow, all the way through Friday, 7 to 9 each evening. It is, how do we describe what they're trying to do? It's something like a VBS. It's something like an evangelistic service, but they have invited us to go and join them in that. And of course, Friday evening, Sinkspiration at the Hiltons. Other announcements or questions? Okay, so yeah, the church didn't get clean this week. If you have an opportunity to just check the calendar in the back and just sign up for church cleaning, that is a blessing to everybody else here.
Pastor?
Yes?
VBS meeting next Sunday?
Yes, sir. Next Sunday, the 4th, June 4th, at noon, Vacation Bible School meeting to try to wrap up any loose ends. Our sister church this morning is Northeast Baptist Church in Millerton, New York. It is one of six original churches in our Northeast Regular Baptist Fellowship, 1947. And then other churches came very quickly behind it. But it's been a faithful church to the Lord. They love the Lord there. And thankful for Pastor Rick Totten, who is leading them. Our missionaries this week are Travis and Becky Gravely. Travis is his primary job is really recruitment to the mission. They call it enlistment, which means he's also telling people not to come. This mission probably won't fit you, that type of thing. But then he's the one who has to prepare them, go through the application process, the training process, and get them all the way until they leave for the field. So Travis has a fairly big job. I'm so glad for their godly children and their testimony of their children. Sam graduates here in a few weeks from the Christian school where he's been attending, but he received a nationwide Christian scholarship and is going to use that at Faith Baptist Bible College training for the pastorate. So glad for that family and for their love for the Lord. We'll ask the ushers to come and we will receive our offering for this morning. Father, thank you for providing our needs, and sometimes we don't know where our supply is going to come from. Sometimes it's difficult to know what you're doing, and we do have doubts at times, but Father, we come to you with those. We also come to you with our lives, and we lay our lives on the altar for you to use, and then we come to you with our stuff. It's your stuff to begin with, and we give it to you wisely, stewarding it for your glory and for your purposes, and we ask for your blessing on this offering at this time. We ask for Northeast Baptist Church in Millerton, New York, that you would honor their worship of you this morning and use them to reach their community for Christ. And I pray for the Gravely family. Thank you for their testimony as a family of loving you. Thank you for their friendship and partnership through the years. And we ask for your blessing on their ministry, for you to help them and give them wisdom, and then to give them endurance. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. pianist back this week.
Amen.
That song was the theme song for the conference she attended last weekend. The conference had four general sessions, four main sessions out of Romans chapter 6. Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How can you that are dead to sin continue any longer in it? And then describing how we are to yield ourselves to God and to know that we are no longer owned by sin if we're believers, and then how we are to let Him work in our lives. And that song, the theme song, is basically Romans 6 kind of worked together into a theme. We'd invite you to take your Bibles for our scripture reading. I'm going to go to Luke chapter 7. Luke chapter 7. The Messiah answers our doubts. He welcomes us to bring our questions to Him, and then He calms our fears and answers our questions. So Luke chapter 7, starting in verse 18, the disciples of John showed Him all of these things, again, the miracles Jesus had been doing. And John, calling unto Him two of His disciples, sent them to Jesus, saying, Art Thou He that should come, or should we look for another? When the men were come unto Him, they said, John the Baptist has sent us to you, saying, Are you he that should come, or should we look for another? And in the same hour He cured many of their infirmities and plagues and of evil spirits, and unto many that were blind He gave sight. Then Jesus answered, sent to them, Go your way, tell John what things you have seen and heard. How that the blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, to the poor the gospel is preached. And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. So when the messengers of John were departed, he began to speak unto the people concerning John. What went you out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken with the wind? What went you out to see? A man clothed in soft raiment? Behold, they which are gorgeously appareled and live delicately are in king's courts. But what went you out to see? A prophet? Yea, more than to you, and much more than a prophet. This is he of whom it is written, Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. For I say unto you, among those that are born of women, there is not a greater prophet than John the Baptist, but he that is least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. And all the people that heard him and the publicans justified God, being baptized with the baptism of John. But the Pharisees and lawyers rejected the counsel of God against themselves, being not baptized by him. And the Lord said, Whereunto then shall I liken the men of this generation, and what are they like? They are like children sitting in the marketplace, calling to one another and saying, We have piped to you and you haven't danced. We have mourned to you and we haven't wept, and you haven't wept. For John the Baptist came neither eating bread nor drinking wine, and you say, He has a demon. The Son of Man has come eating and drinking, and you say, Behold, a gluttonous man and a winebibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. But wisdom is justified of all her children. We'll look at that in a moment. The Messiah answers our questions. Let's take our hymnals again. Hymn number 381. 381. Let's stand as we sing this. Stretch a little bit.
Spirit, washed in His blood.
Again, our same insert, the back side is, by faith we see the hand of God. We'll sing both verses and then a chorus, two verses and a chorus.
By faith we see the hand.
Luke chapter 7, we'll start with really a little bit before verse 18 and thinking about the original few verses of this chapter, the first few verses where Jesus has healed this centurion's servant and Jesus has raised this young man to life. And then in verse 17, Luke chapter 7 says, "This rumor of them went out through all Judea and throughout all the region round about." Verse 18, "And the disciples of John showed him all these things." So we saw the centurion's great faith in a seemingly hopeless situation. His servant was dying, and he had faith in the Messiah, and the Messiah healed. But then the Messiah went and raised from the dead a man of a widow, only child of a widow. And it appears that there was really no faith at all even listed in that story. But the Messiah, because of his care for this widow and for the son, raised him from the dead. I'd like you to keep your finger here in Luke 7 and turn back to Luke chapter 3. Luke chapter 3, verse 16. Back when John the Baptist was introducing Jesus. Luke 3:16, John answered, saying to them all, "I indeed baptize you with water. One mightier than I is coming, the latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to unloose. He will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor. He will gather the wheat into his garner, but the chaff he will burn with fire unquenchable." Oh boy, Messiah is coming, and he's going to let you have it. You can just prefigure this rough guy in rough skins, and his beard is growing all over, scraggly everywhere, and he's just letting these guys have it, fire and brimstone. And he's introducing Messiah in this way. John had great expectations for the Messiah. Were those expectations valid? Why wasn't he seeing these lived out? He's now thinking he may have made a mistake. In verse 19, he says, hey, you two, come over here. Go and ask that Jesus guy if he's the one that we were looking for, or if we should expect somebody else. See, John has been pouring his heart and life into preaching this doctrine of repentance and turning to God and living for him. He had confronted Herod. We hear that over in Mark, in Matthew, in those passages, that he had gone to Herod and said, "You should not have your brother's wife. That was a bad thing to do, you naughty boy, you." And I don't think he said it in that way. I don't think there's any sarcasm at all. He just told him off. Said, "You've just earned God's judgment." And Herod said, "Oh yeah? I'll show you what judgment is." And he threw John in prison. And that made John kind of wonder what was going on here. He's introduced Messiah as one who's going to come and clean house. And Herod is still there. And John's life is now reduced to four stone walls. Probably cold stone walls. His ministry is gone. He's just preaching to the walls or the rats or whatever it is now. So he has doubts. What does he do with his doubts? I'm sure you've woken up some mornings and said, "How in the world did I get into these four walls? Where is God in all of this? Where is the Savior that promised me life eternal, joyful life, abundant life? Where is that Messiah?" Well, when he sends the question, how is the Messiah going to respond? Is the Messiah going to stomp on him? What's the Messiah going to do for an answer? Well, verse 20, when the men were come to him, they said, "John the Baptist sent us to you, saying, are you he that should come, or should we look for another?" I'm saying the main point here is that the Messiah welcomes our questions. He wants us to come to him with our questions. And the context is that John is hearing things in verse 18. He hears some of the things the Messiah is doing. John is experiencing things himself that don't quite match up. Jesus is preaching about a kingdom, and John is saying, "Bring it on," but yet, what am I doing here in this prison? So the question, the content of the question is, should we look for somebody else? And as I mentioned earlier, I don't think this is just saying, "Messiah, if you're not going to do your job, we can replace you." I also don't think And this is really, I think, the crux of this morning. What I want you to understand this morning is that this question is not John rejecting his faith. It is possible to have doubts. It's possible to have questions and to bring them to the Messiah and not lose our faith in the process. He wants to answer our questions. I don't think John is rejecting Jesus as the Messiah. He's just wondering. He's looking for affirmation or confirmation. Maybe one way to put it is this. Most true disciples have doubts. We have questions. We say, well, I come to Luke and I say, I don't know. Well, just last week, for instance, I'll just throw this one at you. So Luke talks about the centurion. He said the centurion sent a couple of his, sent the Jews to ask Jesus to come and heal his son. Well, over in Matthew, it says that the centurion asked Jesus. So is this contradicting itself? And then you have to come to Jesus with that question. You say, what's going on? Well, the centurion had authority to ask somebody and said, go ask Jesus. So the centurion asked Jesus to come heal his son. And that would be the way that I solved that, biblically putting both things together. But I wasn't questioning whether Jesus was my Savior or not, or whether he was trustworthy or not, or whether he told me the truth or not. So most true disciples have doubts that are expressed as questions. We come to him with questions. But I'm going to say this. Most false disciples ask questions to excuse the rejection of Jesus. So they've already rejected Jesus, and they're coming to say, well, what about this? Well, what about that? Well, what about this? Well, what about that? They've already rejected him, and they're looking for an excuse to affirm themselves in their rejection. So John believes in the Messiah, but he has doubts. So he comes to Jesus with the questions. Well, the causes of the questions, and again, why do we have questions like this? And let's face it, we all have different things that happen to us that say, man, how did we get here? Luke has talked in the past chapter 6, about those who were cursed and despised for having faith in Jesus. So that may be one reason, is we believed in Jesus and now people are cursing us because of that, and they're making fun of us or persecuting us, or we lose our job or something like that. Sometimes we have questions because circumstances are painful. What was John's reward for trusting Christ and following him and serving him? Get thrown in prison. What reward is that? How good is that? Well, we have questions. So you may stand up for Christ at work and you lose your position. Or you get passed over for a promotion. You take a stand for God's morality and you lose a friend. And this is painful, and you have questions. Sometimes culture goes in a different direction than you do. There were crowds of people, and we'll see this all through Luke, where there's some people that are following Christ and some that are not, but there were crowds of people getting baptized under John. They were believing his message. Jesus has been teaching, and now some of those disciples of John are jumping ship, you might say. So they listen to John. And they say, John, I think we're with you. And they're baptized by John to identify themselves with John's message. But then they hear Jesus and they say, oh. So just for instance, in chapter 6, Jesus preaches about what a true follower of him looks like. And they say, I don't think so. That isn't really what I had in mind. I was looking for a different kind of Messiah. So they are rejecting the Messiah. And Satan uses culture that does this to mess with our minds. The people around you will ask you questions. They will make statements. So you're one of those people that, and you say, yeah, I guess I am. But Satan is doing this to kind of twist and to turn our minds upside down and to cause questions. Sometimes customs distort our vision of truth. So verse 20, are you the one that should come or should we look for somebody else? What were they expecting? What were the Jews expecting? They were expecting somebody to come and overthrow the Romans. That was what the culture of the Jews was expecting. And in our culture in 2023, people come to church expecting certain things to happen, expecting a certain kind of Messiah. As we're going through the book of Revelation in Sunday school, one of the questions this morning is what kinds of things might people be looking for in a church? What kinds of things might a people be looking for in a Messiah? And how might that go south? How might that go sour? And people might be expecting something that isn't true. Remember over in the book of Matthew, Jesus asked his disciples, so who do people say that I am? Oh, you're Elijah or Moses or one of the other prophets. Well, who do you say I am? You're the Messiah. You're the Christ. And sometimes Satan uses the people around us to distort our vision of truth. And we say, maybe they're right. Maybe I'm wrong. And we have doubts. Well, sometimes our comprehension of Scripture is minimal or inadequate. And that was what was happening with the Messiah picture. They had one side of the Messiah picture correct. He's going to rule one day. But they didn't have the suffering Savior side of the Messiah. And what Jesus was coming to do 2,000 years ago was to be the suffering Savior. He's returning to be the glorious conquering king. Both are true, but they only saw part of it. And often, even as a pastor, I find myself focusing on one aspect of Scripture, one aspect of the Messiah, and then I miss something else. So is it true that he will set up his kingdom? Yes, but not right now. But then I would just give a last reason why we may have doubts, and that is when contempt for the Messiah rules your heart, where you just don't want anything to do with him. And Satan will provide all of the doubts you need. He'll provide you questions, more than questions enough, to affirm you in your doubts. That's rejection of the Messiah, not merely doubting him. Well, how does the Messiah come back to them? Verse 21. Look up here. So, are you the one that we should expect, or should we look for somebody else? Watch this. And what does he do? The same hour, he just starts doing what the Messiah was said was in the Old Testament was going to do. He cured many of their infirmities and plagues and delivered them from the evil spirits, and to many that were blind he gave sight. And then he said, go your way, tell John the things you have seen and heard. How? The blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, to the poor the gospel is preached. Blessed is he whoever shall not be offended in me. That's the Messiah's response. He answers the questions with evidence. This isn't a blind faith that we're expected to believe Christ blindly. He gives every evidence that we need to trust in him. And that's what he did to John. And then he explained that evidence with the truth about himself in verse 22 and 23. He basically is going back to Isaiah 61, Isaiah 35, other passages that explained what the Messiah was going to do and was going to be like. So Jesus did it, and then he said, here's what the Old Testament said I was going to do. Go tell John you saw these things. Interesting that Luke is writing, remember in chapter 1, I'm writing to lay out in an organized way the things that we know, the truth that we know about the Messiah. Why? So we can be certain of the things that have come to pass. And Luke is laying out, and I'm just picturing Theophilus reading these chapters. Say, ah, I see now. Ah, that affirms me in my faith. I trust Christ. There's a quote there that came out of a commentary. God is the friend of the honest doubter who dares to talk to God rather than about him. Now, isn't that interesting that sometimes when we have doubts, we talk to everybody but God? We go everywhere except for God's word for answers. Where do we go first? We usually go to YouTube. We find some quack on there that will agree with us. And they'll affirm us in our doubts. But why not go to God himself and say, God, what is your answer to this question? Prayer that includes an element of questioning God may be a means of increasing one's faith. God, I just don't know about this. Help me. It reminds me of the one father who had the sick child. Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. So we say, Lord, I want to trust you. I think you're my only hope, but I'm having a hard time right now. So it may be a way of increasing our faith, expressing doubts, crying out about unfair situations in the universe, show one's trust in God and one's confidence that God should and does have an answer to humanity's insoluble problems. Isn't it interesting that we come up as humans to problems and we say, there's no way, there's no way. And we take those problems to God, and God affirms our faith. He doesn't undermine it. He doesn't stomp on us for bringing our questions. Well, what does Jesus do next after giving this evidence to John's disciples? Notice they go away, verse 24, when the disciples or the messengers of John were departed. What is Messiah going to do now? How dare John question me? He was my cousin. He had been shown by God who I was. Who was he to question me? You guys don't be like him. But that isn't how Jesus responded at all, is it? He doesn't criticize him because he dared to ask a question. He actually commends those who will honestly trust in him. So immediately after this, he began to speak to the people concerning John. So he's going to say good things about John. Man, there was never a greater prophet than John the Baptist, he says. Do you have a friend like this who, when you've had a little bit of a doubt, they'll turn around and talk to your friends and say, that person, what faith they have in God. What a servant of God they are. And that's what Jesus does for John. He was a man of conviction, verse 24. What did you go out to see? A reed shaken with the wind? You can picture cattails down in the swamp. John was down at the Jordan River, which was kind of a lazy river, swampy in places. And here's these reeds blowing back and forth. And what was John? He was solid. You didn't see a reed shaking the wind in John, Jesus is saying. He was a man of conviction. It was going to take a lot more than wind to make him change his mind. He was solid in his faith. He was a man of courage, verse 25. What did you go out to see? This man clothed in soft raiment? Behold, they which are gorgeously apparelled, they live delicately. They're in the king's courts. That wasn't John. John had Carhartts he wore. You know, it's funny, I sat down to eat yesterday, and it was really informal, you know, we're milling all over the place, and sat down next to one lady, and it wound up being the lady that Kate had been kind of the, not babysitter, but kind of a nanny for the kids. And she said, yeah, I'm usually Carhartts. and it is funny at a wedding to look around and say, you're a little out of character today, aren't you? And this isn't how you usually dress, is it? And John says, or Jesus says, yeah, you usually look for those dressed in all their finery in the king's houses. That wasn't John. John had courage. He stood up. He's in the jailhouse, put there by the prince, by the king, because of standing up against the king. He wasn't about living delicately. He's a man of purpose. 26, what did you go out to see? A prophet? No, I say to you, much more than a prophet. He was more than just somebody representing God. This is he of whom it is written, behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. This is the forerunner to the Messiah. He's far more than a prophet. I say to you, among those that are born of women, there's not a greater prophet than John the Baptist. So he was a man of purpose. And it seems, again, read Luke in Luke's purpose of writing, that Luke is just screaming on paper to Theophilus, look at him. That's the Messiah. But don't hold your questions. Bring your doubts to Jesus and let him answer them. So what is Messiah's response to us? Follow John's example. Encourage people around you to follow John's example. Bring your questions to the Messiah. If the club that you belong in, I'm going to use that, just the term club. So just picture us as a club here this morning. If the club you belong to doesn't allow questions, you're in the wrong club. But a church is not a club, is it? A church is a flock that's following our Savior, following the Messiah. And he invites us to bring questions to him. I'll also encourage you to follow the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Jesus, when he left earth, John 15, said, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. He's going to teach you. He's going to help you to understand these things. So when you cooperate with the Holy Spirit, when you submit to him and you allow him to teach you through his word, he will answer your questions for you. But then I'll also add to that this, be submissive to what you already know. So many times where I see people running into trouble in their lives is they're not doing what they already know to do. And then they have questions over here. One question that I've thought of several times when somebody is really jumping ship, you might say, abandoning Christ, actually rejecting Christ, is the question I have is, so when did you start living immorally? When did you move in with your girlfriend? When did you start doing drugs and were starting to be controlled by that instead of by Christ? And we start looking at things, and often we find somebody who is worshiping something other than Christ. And then the Satan will provide any amount of questions and doubts to affirm them in that. So follow submissively the truth that you already know. Say, Lord, I don't quite understand it, but here's what you've told me, and I'm going to do it with your help. Submission to the Messiah leads to understanding and strengthening in our faith. Keep your finger here. I want you to see the verse, John chapter 7. So you're in Luke, just the next book towards the back of your Bible is John chapter 7. Verse 17. Let's start with verse 16. Jesus, John 7:16. Jesus answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine, but his that sent me. If any man will do his will, in other words, if you want to do God's will, he will know of the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak only of myself. He that speaks of himself seeks his own glory. He that seeks the glory that sent him, the same is true. No unrighteousness is in him. And basically, Jesus is saying, I came representing the Father, and if you want to know his will, he will show it to you. And this really causes us to say we have two choices, either to submit to God or not. And when we don't, more doubts come. So submissively act on the clear biblical truth you already know. And then be deeply rooted in Scripture. Study the Scripture some more. Well, I already have. Well, study it some more. Well, I already have. Well, study it some more. So that you're deeply rooted to be able to help others in their questions. Several places throughout the New Testament talks about this. Somebody comes to you, says, man, how do you have hope in a situation like you're going through? Well, 1 Peter says to be ready with an answer to those who ask you why you have the hope you have, the reason of hope that's in you. So be ready and study out the Scriptures. The third main point, starting in verse 30, on down through verse 35, the end of the section, is that the Messiah, Jesus, knows the difference between doubting the truth and purposely rejecting the truth. So verse 29, all the people that heard him, the just publicans, justified God, being baptized with the baptism of John, but the Pharisees and lawyers rejected the counsel of God against themselves, being not baptized of him. So what's that talking about? Some people went down to hear John preach. In fact, a lot of them did. The Pharisees went down. The scribes went down to hear John preach. Some said, we believe God. They justified God. They said, God's right. And they were baptized by John. The Pharisees and scribes said, nah, I don't think so. Notice the contrast. Verse 29, they justified God. But, verse 30, the Pharisees and lawyers rejected the counsel of God against themselves. This wasn't John's testimony against them. This was God's testimony against them. They rejected it. No wonder they had questions. No wonder they had doubts. They rejected what God said. There was no amount of things that Jesus could say at this point that would make them satisfied. They had rejected God. Jesus knows the difference between the two. Notice his story that he says. Again, picture 29, verse 29 and 30. Here's the tax collectors, the sinners, quote unquote, that have trusted the Messiah. And here's the Pharisees, on the other hand, who haven't. They've rejected him. So in verse 31, what shall I liken the men of this generation? And Jesus is looking at them. He's surrounded by all of them, and he's looking straight at them. He's saying, what are you guys like? What do I compare you to? Well, they're like children, verse 32, sitting in the marketplace, calling to one another, saying, we have piped to you, and you haven't danced. We have mourned to you, and you haven't wept. There is this practice of rejecting God's word, where there's the one crowd declaring God just and the other rejecting what God has said. Then there's this picture of children. Hey, let's play wedding. Yesterday was a good example of this. Some of us are just going, it's hot. I don't want to play. Okay, so. But children playing in the street. Hey, let's play a game. Let's play wedding. I don't like fun games. Okay, well, let's play funeral. I don't like sad games. Well, what do you want to play? Just not that. Right, so not satisfied with whatever. Well, what is Jesus talking about? Verse 33, John the Baptist came neither eating bread or drinking wine. You say, he has a demon. He's demon-possessed. So John came preaching judgment and repentance, and the Pharisees didn't like that. Well, Jesus came, verse 34, eating and drinking and spending time with people. And they didn't like that either. He came offering joy. He came offering forgiveness. He came offering to restore a relationship with those who had broken the relationship with God. He says, here's how you can have a relationship with me. And they didn't like that either. Verse 35, the practice of true faith, wisdom, is justified by all her children. In other words, if you have wisely chose to trust Christ, that will be seen in the way that you then live your life. This really goes back to Luke chapter 6, 43 through 46 is talking about the good tree bringing forth good fruit and the corrupt tree bringing forth corrupt fruit. Wisdom is justified by all our children. It shows what is in your heart. Is your heart rejecting Christ, or is your heart accepting him? If your heart has accepted him, you're truly wanting to trust him, he welcomes you to come to him with your doubts. If your heart is rejecting him, it doesn't matter how many questions you come with, he will never satisfy you with his answers because you've already rejected him. The problem wasn't in God's message, the Messiah's message. It wasn't in Messiah himself. It was in the people who either accepted him or rejected him. Proud, unbelieving people find reasons not to believe. Submissive, humble, believing people bring questions to Jesus, and he very graciously answers them for us. Some applications as we wrap up. I think a good place to start is with the submission thing. Am I submitting to God? Am I willing to do what he says? When I open my Bible and read it, am I willing to do what I read today? Or will I find a reason to say, I don't think I want to do that? God, do you have anything else in mind? Submissively listen to God and do what he says. Ask yourself the question, could my doubts actually be the excuse that I'm trying to use to live my life my own way? It's possible that that's true. So it's a good question to ask. But on the other hand, it could also be just a matter of you having a doubt and you taking it to Jesus and he answers you. Second application is you could ask yourself something like this. If Jesus answers all my questions, am I willing to trust him? That may be a question that you ask somebody that you're sharing Christ with. Maybe you've been coming right up against him, butting heads against him, and you don't know where to go next. You've shared the gospel over and over. You've answered questions, and you might say, could I ask you something? If God answered every single question that you have, would you be willing to trust him? Sometimes they're not. Ask yourself that as well. So understand that even godly people have had doubts. John the Baptist has. Base your faith not on the answers to the questions. Base your faith on the Messiah himself, on Christ himself. He's willing to answer your questions, but the questions and answers themselves will not give you anything solid to trust. It's Christ himself who is our solid rock that we build our faith in. I'd encourage you to read the scriptures, read the Old Testament, read the prophecies about the Messiah. So when you read the Gospels, you're saying, there is the Messiah, this side of it coming out in this passage. And do some research on the Messiah and the prophecies about him. Read the Gospels. Look for Jesus in the Gospels. Don't just look for answers to questions, but look for Jesus himself. And then once again, finish up with, am I willing to submit to what he's telling me? And the encouragement, he always accepts our questions and answers them if we come to him in faith. Let's take our hymnals as we finish up. 385. Really a good way for us to end this morning. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. The Messiah welcomes our questions. He answers our questions. He loves to have us come to him if we trust him and obey him. 385, let's stand as we sing. When we walk with the Lord, If you're here this morning, you've never trusted Christ to forgive your sins. He is the Messiah sent from God himself, the Son of God, who became man, lived a perfect life, died in our place for us. No amount of goodness can earn us favor with God. It's simply by trusting in him that we are saved. I would invite you to trust Christ this morning. But believer, are you chafing against him? Is he pulling on the reins, on the bit in your mouth, and you're just fighting against him? Satan will provide all of the questions you need to affirm you in your disbelief if that's the direction you keep going. I would urge you to submit to God. Trust him. Bring your questions honestly to him, being willing to accept them. Father, help us as we go. Thank you for the work you do in our hearts and lives and softening us and preparing us. Thank you for providing Christ. Help us to trust him fully. Help us to bring our doubts to him. In Jesus' name, amen. You're dismissed.